All right, thank you. And good afternoon and welcome to the DoubleLine webcast with Jeffrey Gundlach. I'd like to announce some thought leadership. We're in the media and some new recent material is in light of the Ukraine-Russia crisis. We have a new roundtable, geopolitical roundtable, featuring portfolio managers Bill Campbell and Valerie Ho, moderated by our deputy CIO, Jeffrey Sherman. Also, our YouTube channel, you can go to our channel 11, hosted by our Ken Shinoda. And then lastly, we have a couple of podcasts, the widely acclaimed Sherman Show podcast, and then Monday Morning Minutes with Sam Lau and Jeff Mayberry. All of those can be viewed or listened to at DoubleLine.com, iTunes, SoundCloud, Google Podcasts, Spotify. So without further delay, I'd like to turn the webcast over to Mr. Jeffrey Gundlach.
Breaker 1-9, this here's a rubber duck. You got a copy on me, love machine. Aw, 10-4, pig pen. For sure, for sure. By golly, it's clean, clear to Taco Town. Yeah, we definitely got us the front door, good buddy. Mercy sakes alive, looks like we got us a convoy.
Arizona, noon on the 7th of June, when they highballed over the pass. Bulldog Mac with a can on back and a Jaguar hauling ass. He's 10 on the floor, stroking bores, seat cover starting to gain. Now, Beaver, you are trucking with a rubber duck, and I'm about to pull a plug on your drain.
All right, everybody. Welcome to our first Total Return webcast here for 2022. I named this Convoy. It started out to have two meanings. It was about the convoy in Canada, which I thought was somewhat inspiring. Canadians are so typically so very, very polite and docile. I thought it was really a remarkable change in the sort of societal mood that these truckers up in Canada got angry enough to take things into their own hands. And then we had that remarkable response from the Trudeau government. Canadians are usually so polite that we have some very good Canadian clients that tell me that if you get into a car accident and it's your fault in Canada, the Canadian that you hit very often apologizes to you. So it takes a lot to get the Canadians going. Here's a picture of them with their maple leaf flags. The other meaning of convoy was chosen because of the movement in the commodity market, which is just running like a runaway convoy, like in that song that was popular back when I was a kid in the middle of the 1970s, when the CB craze was raging in the United States. So it was about the commodity prices, and then as it turned out, here's some U.S. people showing solidarity with the Canadians. But then all of a sudden in recent days, it's been a little bit darker of a convoy. And this is that strange convoy that's mired outside of Kyiv. And apparently it's 40 miles long and it hasn't moved in a long time. I've heard many theories about why that convoy is not moving. And some people say the tires are no good. Some people say tanks that were supposed to help chaperone it got blown up. Some people say it's just a decoy. It's just a way of making it look like they were headed into Kyiv, and maybe they were, with hope for a two-day victory. But that, if that was Mr. Putin's hope, obviously did not materialize. And so there you have it. I'd like to bring up one other thing on convoy, and that is the bloodless verdict of the market, as it's been a horrific start to the year for markets globally, with the rising commodity prices, oil over $120 a barrel. It was only at $80 for West Texas Intermediate a few months ago. And that's led to returns of negative signs and basically everything except real assets. Year to date, there's a lot of dispersion there. Some countries, I think the UK is holding up pretty well. And then we have the MSCI World Index is down 13. So pretty much stocks, if you glom it all together, they're down about 13%. and there's almost nowhere to hide. We've seen interest rates rise this year and then level off. And not the short end, though. The two-year Treasury is at the high yield of the year as I'm speaking. It was gone up from 72 basis points or so at year-end to 160 basis points today. That's the highest in this year and in this cycle. So, of course, the two-year Treasury, as I'll talk about, definitely leads the Fed. The Fed doesn't need to be listened to. All you've got to do is watch the two-year Treasury. I'll prove that in a few slides. Basically, what the two-year Treasury is telling us is that the Fed may raise rates six times, not necessarily this year, but in the next couple of years. Five-year Treasury yield is also up less than the two-year. The yield curve has been flattening, which I'm going to talk about, from 124 to 180. The high on five-year was 195, so we're 15 basis points below the high of the year. The 10-year Treasury from 152 to 185, so the 10-year Treasury only yields 5 basis points more than the five-year. So what the market is predicting is a flat yield curve very soon. The high on the 10-year was 204, so it is 19 basis points below its high of the year. The 30-year Treasury has gone up the least, 192 to 223. High was 235, so that's just 12 basis points below its high. So we're hovering. It doesn't really feel like it because equities are so weak. It doesn't really feel like bonds the yields are up near their highs on the short end, but they are, and they're near their highs also in the intermediate term maturities. So there you have it. We now have positive yields on the 10-year in Japan, 15 basis points. It's been there a few times over the many years, but it was negative forever, as we all remember. And then the German government bond, the 10-year, is now at 11 basis points, having been about 100 basis points lower at the negative 80 basis points or so at its low. So the convoy is running along. I expected that we would get a bounce that was better than the bounce today in the S&P 500. The VIX was up near pushing 40. That's usually the sign that a short-term exhaustion point might be being reached. And it looked like it this morning, but the action in the afternoon was very poor. So I think all that got accomplished today, unfortunately, was short covering. And that short covering dissipated, and the market closed down moderately on the day. So there we have it. Let's go through some of the slides. And I'm going to do what we've been doing in our new format with Andrew, going through the funds details. I'm going to start out with a macro overview and some ideas on markets. And then after Andrew, I'll answer a few questions that represent what seems to be the mood of what the audience is looking for. We always get many, many more questions we can possibly even read during the course of this, so I'll do my best. So here's the real Fed funds rate. So this is probably the last time it's going to be at a zero Fed funds rate for a long time. The Fed's going to raise rates 25 basis points. That's well telegraphed. We need to take basically zero on Fed funds and subtract a 7.5% CPI, you get a negative 7.4% real Fed funds rate. As I've talked about in the past, these are Jimmy Carter-like negative interest rates. Another reason why I thought of Convoy for this webcast is that was basically in the days of that boy song with the CB radio. So it reminded me again of the 70s era. So some people are bringing out the narrative that with the war in Ukraine, the Fed is less likely to be as aggressive raising rates. I completely disagree with that. I think what's happened is obvious with the Bloomberg Commodity Index now up something like 35% year to date, and oil over $120 a barrel, and fertilizer prices exploding, and natural gas in short supply, and wheat and corn and everything else. I think the inflation rate is not going to peak out at 7.5 on the CPI. I think we're headed to, well, it depends where commodities go, but I think we could be headed to a 10% CPI, certainly a 9% CPI before we get any relaxation. So that's something to be watching out for. If we're going to get a 9% CPI, I can't possibly see how the Fed can pull back on interest rate increases. Their job is to fight inflation. They've done a terrible job of it so far. All they did was try to jawbone it down, say it was temporary or transitory, but it's still going higher. And that's likely to continue as the inflation convoy keeps rolling along. So we might have inflation go up even more than the Fed funds rate. So this chart might get more negative. It might even be more negative should we choose to use it in our next webcast. So bonds just look incredibly overvalued with the 10-year at 1.85% and the inflation rate at 7.5%. So even at the 10-year, we have substantial negative interest rates. Usually the Fed follows the two-year Treasury. I think they've started to do that. That's the thing they really follow. But here historically on the screen, you'll notice the Fed funds rate, which is the red line, it is very highly correlated to wage growth on the right-hand side. That's the employment cost index, wage and salaries. You can see that typically the Fed actually seems to kind of anticipate wage growth picking up and moves a little bit before the wage growth. This time, they didn't anticipate it at all. I mean, the wage growth is up at seven on the right-hand scale. It's up at 4.5% or so. And of course, the Fed funds rate is nowhere close. So the Fed has changed its modus operandi versus this series, which goes back nearly 40 years. And there certainly looks like they need to raise rates with the inflation rate not relaxing so far, and not likely to relax in the few months ahead at all either. So the economy is really screwed up, and it's hard to look at economic data and draw historical conclusions because everything is so manipulated. This is a series that I'm using because it's so heavily different than it was in the past. We have the blue line, which is PCE durable goods. No, the blue line is PCE non-durable goods. The black, I'm sorry, I've got two different displays of different colors. I'll just stick with the one on the screen. The blue is the durables. The black the black is non-durables, and the red line is services. Okay, so that's the order. So notice that all three of these, durables, non-durables, and services, were going along pretty in line with each other from 2016 until the lockdown of the pandemic. And then all of a sudden, all the government money started being sprayed around. And we saw that didn't really go to services. Services weren't really that available for much of that time period. But look what happened to the blue line, the durables. The durables just went totally off trend and so elevated that one has to believe that future economic growth, because durable spending is a long-term purchase decision, that some of these durable goods have been pulled forward from the future. And it looks like rather a lot of them. So one of the things that people are talking about with, and I think appropriately so, with these commodity price increases of sort of historic proportions, we're going to have demand destruction because a lot of money is going to have to go to food and energy. Gas prices here in California are over $7 a gallon right now. And that doesn't even include probably the effects of the 30% increase in crude oil over the past week. Or even greater than that over the past week. So it's going to be a lot of demand destruction. Some people are calling for inflation. The yield curve, some people are calling for recession. The yield curve is corroborating that with somewhat with its flatness. And we're starting to see, I don't have the slide in the deck, we're starting to see consumer sentiment flagging, even in the view of the present. In fact, USA Today had a survey out last week asking people, probably their readers, what do you think of the economy presently? And 51% of the respondents said that they think we're either in a recession presently or a depression presently. And that corroborates with the University of Michigan consumer sentiment, which the view of the present has rapidly deteriorated. But we can just see how distorted a big part of the economy was in durable goods and non-durable goods in the PCE from the government money. And there has to be a payback for this. And it's with what's going on, it may be coming in the few quarters ahead. The trade deficit has increased mightily since all that money was passed out to U.S. citizens at a greater level than other countries did. We can see the trade deficit was stable for about 8 years at around $60 billion or so. And now it's up by about 80%. Since the money started to be thrown around. So the trade deficit is very, very high. This shows some of the effect of all that money printing we did. Here is the congestion. People spoke a lot about the bottlenecks at the ports. They would be short term, and they would be relieved. But it hasn't happened much at all. In fact, the East Coast, the darker line, that congestion index at ports is at a new high, and not by a small amount. And it's the West Coast, the lighter blue line, is relaxed. But if you put the two together, basically the two together remain at on a combined index at the highest level over this time period of 5 years. So that's another reason why one should not expect a rapid relaxation of inflation. Also, one of the problems we're going to have, speaking of the convoy theme, is I think we're going to have a problem with truckers in terms of not. I'm not talking about a convoy of U.S. truckers, which I think they were talking about. I haven't heard much about that lately. But I'm just talking about recruitment. We were already having problems getting truck drivers a few years back. There were anecdotes of trucking companies hiring people that were over 80 years old to, for the first time, drive a truck, which is kind of frightening when you think about the power of these big rigs. But with what's going on with robotization and perhaps driverless vehicles, maybe not being 50 years out, but way less than that, it's hard for me to wonder why anybody who's 25 years old, say, would want to take out a career in trucking, because their job's probably going to go away well before their retirement age. And so I think we're going to just continue to have costs of transporting goods be stickily difficult for the inflation rate. So one thing that is also should be kept in mind, and we talked about this in the Roundtable Prime back in January, is there's a big fiscal drag that's underway in the United States economy. We had all of that stimulus that led to all that durable goods spending and all that GDP nominally that we've been talking about for the past couple of years now. But look at now what's happening is that the blue line, which is the delta in fiscal policy contribution to growth, has gotten negative. And it's going to get more negative as we get further out this year. It's going to be down about negative 3% of GDP. So we've got the durable goods are likely to fall off. We've got the fiscal from the government that's projected to fall off. And we've got the inflation demand destruction. These are things that have made the economic outlook substantially worse today than where it was, say, in September. And it's so curious how the Fed seems to zig when they're supposed to zag. They were way too easy into about September of last year. And then in September through December, they got really hawkish at a time when they were right when things started to really change in a way that may make them pivot yet again here in 2022. We'll see. For now, everybody expects, and I think the Fed is deeply committed to at least having the appearance of being on the job for the inflation watch. And so they will have to hike rates. This at the same time as QE has stopped. So I talked about this several times last year, that what was holding everything together was zero interest rates. And when you put zero interest rates together with quantitative easing, $120 billion per month, you had a pretty good cocktail for market returns. And I was talking about back in July, I said, well, watch out, because we're about to play the movie that we watched in 2018, which was the Fed raising rates, being forced to by the two-year Treasury, which I'm going to get to again in a few slides, and now the quantitative easing going away, and perhaps even some talk of some maturities being allowed to roll off from the balance sheet. So this is the same cocktail that they served up in the fourth quarter of 2018, and it led to a bear market that a lot of investors don't remember because it happened so quickly, and the Fed pivoted so monumentally in late December and early January of late December 18 and early January of 19. So we'll see what happens here. Right now, what the markets are saying is, you know, you order up the same cocktail, and that's what shows up at the bar, and that's what's happening to these risk assets, which are having one of the worst starts. A 60-40 portfolio is having one of the worst starts, I think, to years for many years. Here's the number of employees, and we can see that we have not made it back to the pre-pandemic level of jobs. So in a certain sense, no jobs have really been created. It's just jobs that were lost or were shuttered for a while. Now some of the workers have returned. But I also think there's something else going on here. And that is that I think the labor force participation rate is lower. I think I have a slide on that in a moment, so let's get to that. One thing that's interesting is with not going back to the same employment in terms of number of employees, still jobs are plentiful. And we know that the unemployment rate is quite low. So the Fed doesn't have any reason with the employment market being at 3.8% or whatever it is unemployment rate. I think that there's no reason for them to forestall interest rate increases based upon the full employment piece of the mandate. But here's the labor force participation rate. And we've got the 25 to 54 year old crowd is the blue line. And then we've got the total is the blue line. So there's a big difference, as we see, between the blue line, which is up at about 66, and the red line, which is down there at 62. But what I'm pointing out here is both of them are about a percentage point or half percentage point below where they were prior to the pandemic. And you might say, well, with all these jobs plentiful, you're wondering why the participation rate hasn't come back. And I think it's because, one, there was so much money given out that a lot of people still have some savings to live off of. A lot of people made 150% more off the government dole and staying at home than they did by actually working. That's actually a fairly common percentage. But I also think what we hit, this is the labor force participation rate. I think the crime force participation rate has taken away some of these workers. I think more people have turned to crime. We see that with crime on the rise everywhere. And we all know about the DA here in Los Angeles County saying it's okay to steal up to a certain amount of money. And when you say that, people do it. It's just like when President Biden in December and then reiterated in January that there was no way we were going to send U.S. troops to Ukraine. Well, that sort of leads to action. If you tell people you can steal $900 and you won't be prosecuted, they might go out and steal $900. Sometimes I wonder when I'm waiting in line why I'm waiting in line to pay. Other people just walk out the door with stuff with no ramifications, but I guess it's because I'm honest. But anyway, I think the crime force participation rate is up. So deterrence does work. Deterrence is necessary. And I think one of the reasons that we're getting sucked into perhaps another war just about 6 months after we exited Afghanistan is we let down the discussion of deterrence after taunting Putin by saying, basically, we're developing a path for Ukraine to join NATO. And one thing that the Russians have been steadfast about for years, there's a clip of Joe Biden back in 1997, and the Russians were saying there's no way we will have a NATO country on our western border. And I think they really mean that. And as we taunted them with perhaps Ukrainian inclusion into NATO while simultaneously saying we weren't really going to defend them, I think that that set up a part of the stage here for, unfortunately, this catalyst for this inflation problem going into another phase. Dollar index has been strong. The dollar index is very highly correlated in the short term to the change in the slope of the yield curve. A lot of people don't know that. I'm gonna show you that in a moment. Well, let's do it right now. This is the Dixie index, which is the red line, and it's compared to the twos tens yield curve difference. So we can see the black line is the twos tens spread. And just look how much it's come down in the last year from 160 basis points nearly down to 22. It actually earlier got to 15 basis points. So we're getting very near a flat yield curve, twos to tens. You'll notice the red line is the dollar. Look how highly correlated these have been. So over the short term, one of the reasons I've been bullish on the dollar against my long-term highly bearish view, I've been bullish on the dollar for the past nearly a year, is because we thought the yield curve would flatten. When the yield curve flattens, the dollar in the short term is supported. And so that's what's been happening here. In the long term, the dollar is highly correlated to the twin deficits. I didn't include the exhibit. I've used it many times before in past webcasts. But if you do the twin deficit, the sum of the trade deficit, which is small compared to the budget deficit, but it's up about 80% in the past 2 years, and the budget deficit, which of course is insanely high, now running at about 12% of GDP, down from 20% or so of GDP at the peak of the profligacy. So here we are, the dollar remains strong. So it's interesting that the international returns on a price basis are so similar, even though the dollar has been very, very strong. One other thing to think about with the dollar being this strong and such a big explosion in commodity prices that in US dollar terms, it means that inflation is just a wildfire, absolutely a screaming convoy, 1,000 screaming trucks for foreigners whose currencies are depreciating while US dollar-based prices are going up. Here's emerging markets versus the S&P 500, which I've talked about. I recommended investors in a kind of a dollar-cost averaging way, sell US stocks and buy emerging market stocks systematically over the course of this year, and I would do it gradualistically. One of the reasons I believe that is, first of all, emerging markets are very cheap. I've talked about this on the CAPE ratio in past webcasts. They're valued less than half of where the U.S. market had been, but also we've had this huge run of about 10 years of U.S. stocks blowing the doors off of non-U.S. stocks. And interestingly, even with all of this turmoil and the stronger dollar, S&P 500 has stopped outperforming emerging market stocks. So that's pretty interesting, particularly with all of this geopolitical problems with Russia. Here's Europe versus the S&P 500, which was hanging in there for a long time. I mean, a year and a half plus. But of course, when you get a war on your Eastern Front, it's not surprising that Europe has been had its challenges, shall we say, over the past couple of weeks. So the outperformance of the United States is there versus Europe for sure. Interestingly, not versus the emerging markets. So I think the regimes, and I've talked about this from time to time in the past 2 years, the regimes that were just on autopilot, you know, growth outperforming value, U.S. outperforming Europe, U.S. outperforming MSCI world, have been gradualistically topping and reversing. And I expect that will continue further and be a theme probably for the next several years to come. When the dollar finally buckles under the weight of the deficits, which might be the next recession. I'm almost positive we'll gun the deficit again if we do get a recession. Well, there will be one, but it might be coming sooner than we thought, might have thought 6 months ago. I think gunning the deficit will be even more aggressive, the gunning of the deficit, even an even bigger convoy of stimulus coming at us. And I think that would probably be the time when U.S. stocks would start underperforming. And there's a long, long way to go. Another thing that's changed, look at the NASDAQ 100 versus the S&P 500. This is a 20-year outperformance that was just relentless, with it outperforming by 3.5x. And now we see that the NASDAQ is underperforming, and the scale here is pretty big. So this is another trend which appears to be reversing. This is one of my favorite slides because it kind of explains the last, 27 years or so that's on the slide here. Basically, the blue line is the Bloomberg Commodity Index, the one that's been exploding lately. You'll notice in the context of this long time frame, it doesn't look like that much. But the blue line is the total return of the commodity index. The red line is the S&P 500. And for completeness, the black line is the Bloomberg Ag. And what I find so fascinating about this chart is from 1995 or even 1994 until 2011, basically, with some divergences here and there, all three of these asset classes had the same total return roughly over that 16-year time period from 95 to 11. And then something happened, and commodities went down, and it's a lot. These scales are very big. So that blue line going down, it doesn't look like a lot in the middle of 15 or so, but it was a lot. And we see the ag grinds along, being boring investment grade bonds. Then you see the S&P 500 just going ballistic, up 400%. Why would that be? Well, I think it's because of zero interest rates. And I think it's because of the Fed growing its balance sheet, which it had for a long time a beneficial effect on risk assets, and particularly equities. There was that tough period there in 2018. There was that tough period, obviously, with the lockdown. But it's incredible. This is the government's involvement So when the government is involved, you get inflation. So when the government gets involved in the deficit and money printing and the like, you got inflation in the S&P 500. And you also had Europe in 2011 say, whatever it takes. And so it was pretty clear that whatever it takes in Europe and their negative interest rates and the Fed growing its balance sheet so much, it led to this incredible outperformance of stocks versus everything else, and particularly U.S. stocks. So this is now changing. You'll notice that the commodities are outperforming the S&P 500 in the recent year and a half. And obviously, you know, bonds are just going sideways. Here's the Bloomberg Commodity Index. And it's so funny because I did a thing with Tony Robbins last Friday, and he had asked me to put a couple of things together. And I had to laugh because I said, you know, everything I put together looks like the slides are like 5 days old, but they look like they're 200 days old because so much has happened. So we take a look at the commodity index here, and it was going up already from the middle of 2020. But then this has just gone absolutely vertical with gaps and runaway gaps. And it's coincidentally, it's the BCOM is weirdly about the same as the price of oil. They're both about 120, 130. So the commodity index has just been absolutely on fire. This is a longer term view. It even looks impressive over this 27-year time period. The magnitude of this move is almost the same size as the magnitude of the move going into the global financial crisis. And I bring that up again because a big up move in commodities, in particular energy commodities, is often a catalyst, and in a postmortem is determined to be part of the causes behind recessionary periods. And so this move is not bullish for the consumer, obviously for discretionary purchases. And we've already had a lot of those durable good purchases. So we're definitely getting more concern about the potential for a recession. But this is a historic commodity move, reminding me once again of the 1970s. Okay, we'll get to here's traditional CPI measures. 7.5 right now for the headline. We have 6 for the core. That headline number, I think we're going to end the year probably with 7.5% inflation. That might be even a good outcome. So that would be 2 years back to back of 7.5. And I'm certain we're going to see some prints here that are make the 2% target look almost like hilariously laughable. And I know that they're talking now about 2% on average, but to counter a couple years of 7.5 inflation, you're going to need many years of inflation of 1% to end up with an average of 2. So things are shifting around. Let's check in on home prices. Home prices are remain quite strong. This is versus the shelter index. I wish we had just used the same scale because this doesn't show it as dramatically as if we use the same scale. But the red line is the Case-Shiller home price index, which remains at about 20% year over year. And then the blue line, that's on the most right-hand scale, that's up about 4.2%. That's the CPI shelter index, which is 1/3 of the CPI index. So that right now, what they're putting into the CPI is fully 16 percentage points less than the actual change in home prices. And they use owner's equivalent rent as a big piece of the shelter index. And apartment rents are going up double digits. They're not going up 4.2%. So this piece of inflation is being underestimated. And I think it's going to start bleeding in. We've talked about this in the past. This could easily raise the CPI by a percentage point and offset, more than offset even, anything that looked like might have been in prospect for supply chain disruptions, which really do not seem to be dissipating at all. So this is an upward inflation impulse. Here's export and import prices. I like looking at these because these don't have all the adjustments that you get in the CPI with X this and X that and hedonic adjustments and replacement and all that. These are actual prices. So here we are with export prices up at 15%. They were 18%. And then we have import prices at 11%. So these are pretty high numbers for export and import prices. And some people think that that's really what the CPI is, because if you didn't adjust the CPI or use the methodology that was in place back in 1982, you would get a much higher number. There's a European way of calculating CPI. If we use that methodology on the U.S. economy, we would be running more like at 8.5% than 7.5%. So there's a lot of reasons to believe that inflation is becoming, you know, just embedded. And don't think that export prices going up doesn't affect U.S. citizens or U.S. consumers, because things that we export, yeah, their prices are up 15%, but we consume some of those domestically. And so those price increases, at least in part, are being felt at the stores here by American citizenry. Here's wage inflation. There's different measures of wage inflation. We've got the purple is average hourly earnings up at 6.6. We've got Atlanta Fed growth at 5.1. That was going sideways for many years. Now it's an obvious trend. And we've got Bureau of Labor Statistics, Employment Cost Index, which is trending higher as well, although it's up about 4%. That's been one of the lower indices out there for quite some time. I think the evidence of higher wage inflation is everywhere. I even saw one of my analysts told me they saw, I think it was a Del Taco fast food joint, where of course they have now hiring signs like all of them, but they actually said $21 an hour entry level to work the cashier. So that's going to filter up the ladder. I think here's the wage growth tracker by age. I've been started to use this. I remember early on in the pandemic, I talked about how it was really only affecting the purple line, which was the young people, 16 to 24 years of age. And for the first year of the lockdowns, you'll notice that the red line, which is the 55 plus crowd, and then the blue line, the black line, they weren't even going up. They were gently declining. And I predicted and feared that that would reverse, that the wage gains at the low end, which were running up about 10%, would end up pushing wages a little bit up the ladder, supervisory workers and higher. And that appears to be happening, because now all of these cohorts are edging up, and in particular that the blue line, the overall, which is being driven, of course, significantly by the purple one, but that's up at 5.1%. And these trends look to be well established. Interestingly, one of the reasons why housing is doing well, I think, is that wage growth, the red line, is higher than the blue line, which is 30-year fixed rate mortgage. Now, I know there's a mismatch there. Wage growth is this year, and a 30-year mortgage rate is for 30 years. But I think if people feel good about wage growth and they notice that wage growth is occurring above the mortgage rate, there's this pretty good incentive. You'll notice that the blue line is usually quite a bit higher than the red line. The wage growth tends to be well below the mortgage rate, and that has been inverted in the last 2 years. And not surprisingly, that's created strength in the housing market. We'll get more into that. Here's another reason why the housing market is strong. This is the supply of existing home sales at the current sell-through rate. And it's at a brand new low again. We thought it was low in 2020, but it's down to 1.6 months at the present. In fact, I got an email from my broker saying, I know you're not selling your house, but I have no supply, and I've got people that are looking, that are cash buyers. I mean, if you've any inkling, just let me know. So they're actually out there cold calling to try to get. And this is a very successful brokerage guy too. Here's more strength of the more signs of the housing market. The 2-year change in the home price index, Case-Shiller National, is now over 30%. So the housing has become significantly less affordable, but the wage growth has been there, at least in the last year or two, to support it. Inflation is a global phenomenon. This is the Citigroup Inflation Surprise Index, and the constituents, all the yellow, all the bright colors, those are surprise indices for various regions of the world. And I'll just point out that every single region is registering above the zero line and has been above the zero line for the past year and is more above the zero line. That's pretty hard to do. Once you've got everything in gear, and it's all going up at a higher level, and it stays there for yet another year, it's tough to get even stronger surprises, because the up move of the year before, it was significant. So we're just building is the message of this exhibit. Let's go into parts of the bond market. I thought it was funny during the Olympics that the two-year, the one on the right, had looked like the half pipe at the Winter Olympics. It's almost, a lot of people don't realize that the increase in the two-year has been virtually as rapid and as steep as the decline was in the aftermath of the lockdowns, where the Fed just slashed rates to zero immediately and promised low rates for a long time. And here you need Dramamine here because of the incredible volatility up and down. Here's my point on the Fed. So this goes back to 2012. The red line is the Fed funds rate, and the blue line is the two-year treasury. So I'm not exactly sure why we need the Fed. Why don't we just save the money on 800 PhD economists and use the two-year? Because it's pretty obvious that the Fed follows the two-year. And you can see the two-year has thrown a fit since late last year. And so, of course, the Fed must get in gear with this. And last time we were in this disconnect, the Fed raised rates all the way up to 2.5%. And long treasuries went to 3.5%. If the past is prologue, the Fed will not be able to raise rates up to even 2.5%. In fact, here's what the bond market thinks is going to be the shape of the yield curve 1 year from today, using the 1 year forwards in the treasury market. Basically, what it says is the Fed's going to raise rates 1 year from now. 1 month money is going to be at 2%. So this was the yield curve saying, this is as of yesterday, 8 hikes from the Fed, likely in the next year, and of 25 each. And at the same time, notice what the market's saying is that the 5-year out to the 30-year will have virtually no change at all. In fact, the 30-year, basically literally no change. So what this bond market pricing is telling you is the bond market says the yield curve is going to be flat at about 2%. And I think that if the bond market's wrong, it's wrong at being too high. I think it might be that the yield curve goes flat at 150. And that would continue the over 40-year trend of every Fed hiking cycle of any significance broke the market at an ever lower yield rate. There are some economists that I respect quite greatly who disagree with me on this. They actually think we've broken the cycle of ever lower interest rates. But I don't think so. I think that this will be a shockingly strange endgame to this journey we've been on for the past, I would say, about 40 years, ever since Reagan took over and started the deficit binge. So copper gold, let's check in on our old friend. It's gotten to a huge divergence that is maintained. Basically, copper gold says the commodity price ratio suggests that the 10-year treasury should be higher than it is today. By a fair amount. I mean, we're at 185 today, and it looks like it should be, based on this ratio, more like about 250 or so. So that it's being overtaken by geopolitical events and commodity prices. Here's the 210s curve that I promised. This is pretty interesting, how much this flattening looks in historical contexts. We got a few times when rates were higher, and the Fed wasn't at a zero policy for such a long time, we used to get the 210s to go out to about 250 basis points. And then that would happen after recessions. And then the yield curve would steepen back out again after the recession. And then you get the curve being flattened by the Fed. And that happens in advance of the recession, of course. And the flat yield curve is a forecaster of recession that is very accurate. You can see the last three recessions, there was a 210s inversion, even before the pandemic. Fascinatingly, we did have a brief moment of inversion. So it's actually 4 for 4. So watch 210s. If this thing goes down to zero, I would say the chance of recession in the next several months goes up to a very, very high percentage. So we're watching this one very carefully. Here's corporate credit returns by letter rating year to date. I went through this in a less granular way when I pointed out that this year investment grade is underperforming with its duration, but this goes back a year. And what we see is now investment grade returns are negative by a few percentage points over the last year. This is the total return, by the way. This includes the income stream. So negative returns there, and high yield is now flirting with zero on the double Bs, but still positive for the 1 year period on the lower rated stuff. But we can clearly see that the double B market has been hit on a year to date basis. Here's corporate spreads by letter rating, and one thing I want to point out is they're widening. This wasn't getting much attention in the fourth quarter of last year. You could almost blame that little move up in November, December to just year-end illiquidity. But then we started to see some real widening. And this is with Treasury rates going up. Keep in mind, Treasury rates are up, as I outlined early in the presentation. They're up by, 50 basis points-ish year-to-date. And so these spreads widening, it means that you really have a deterioration of financial conditions here. Goldman Sachs publishes a widely followed financial conditions index, and it's tightened a lot. Obviously, that has a lot to do with the VIX. It has a lot to do with stocks going down, but it also has to do with these spreads widening. You see, high yield is also widening. The scale's much wider down in the high yield. They've actually widened more than investment grade, but it's because the scale is smaller in the investment grade one, but they're both widening in concert. Default rates are non-existent. One thing that did happen with the government's stimulus programs is it improved the balance sheets of corporate America and reduced their interest expenses a lot, with refinancing accounting for a tremendous amount of corporate bond issuance in the last 2 years. So not surprisingly, with balance sheets in better shape and with inflation now in the mix, default rates are non-existent. So the corporate bond market has a little bit more attractiveness now with wider spreads. It suffers in the investment grade side from a duration problem, but maybe most of that duration problem is also in the rearview mirror for out to 10 to 30 years in the term structure. At least, as I pointed out earlier, that was the message of the bond market. But right now, we just have no defaults. It's really the lowest. You really can't get any lower. So mortgage spreads have widened. A lot of people were talking about what happens if the Fed stops doing QE, what will happen to mortgage spreads? Well, it's already happened. You can see that this is the Morgan Stanley OAS of mortgages, but basically it's the same as the spreads. You can see that the OAS was negative back in March of last year. We talked about it in our call last March, that mortgages, Ginnie Mae's, were about the most overvalued that I'd ever seen them versus treasuries in my career. And that was because, I think, of the Fed's buying and also tremendous bank demand. Banks were flush with deposits from the government money. And so they were buying a lot of mortgages because of their liquidity. And they took them to a negative OAS. But they've widened out by about 80 basis points, 70 or 80 basis points or so. So they're now basically back to kind of a fair value situation. Is it inevitable that an inverted yield curve leads to recession? Inevitable is a very strong word, but it certainly has been the story of history. So I would really say that if you get an inverted yield curve, 2s to 10s, and I also look at 5s to 30s, which is sending less of a signal right now. 5-year to 30-year is more like about 45 basis points. I mean, it changes minute by minute, but the warning signals on the yield curve inversion are when you get inside of 50. And so we've been inside of 50, 5s to 30s from time to time, but we're resting right about at 50. And on 2s, 10s, we've been inside of 50 now for a while, and it's been accelerating. So I do think that if both of those go inverted, the case of recession becomes very, very strong. And so I'd be watching out for that. Many questions on gold. I'm not surprised. Gold has finally started to shine and made it back up to $2,000. And it's even more impressively so with the fact that the dollar's been up. So like I said about commodities broadly, commodities are really up in non-dollar terms. So people are asking, is gold a buy now? I sort of don't think so. I mean, will it go to a new high? Maybe. It's not very far away from where it is now. I just think commodities broadly are a better investment than gold. The trade location for commodities broadly is not great in the short term, But when commodities outperform, when the cycle turns versus, say, the return of the S&P 500 compared to a long-term commodity existing index like the Goldman Sachs Commodity Index, once the commodities bottom out versus the S&P's total return, it tends to go on for a long time, and it tends to be a very large amount. So sometimes as much as 8 or 9x outperformance from the bottom of the commodity cycle to the top of the commodity cycle. I've shown the slides, we've had a big commodity move, but it's not 8 or 9 times stocks. And I think the commodity cycle has turned, and it's really turned sort of with a vengeance and cut. But I do think that if you're a true long-term investor and you think gold fits in your portfolio, I do not have a problem owning gold. I own gold presently, and I haven't added to it in a long time. But I do think that when the dollar falls, which will take the next recession, I think. So I don't think this is a short-term recommendation by any means, but I do think that gold will have a good principal protection aspect or purchasing power protection aspect. Someone says a lot about commodity prices. Will these moves cause demand deflation? I don't know about demand deflation. I mean, it is true that high prices are the cure for high prices, but what first happens is the prices are going up is people don't have the money. When you're paying $2 a gallon more for gas than you did 2 years ago, and you're paying 50% higher for cereal and meat and the like, which I think is coming, that causes demand deflation away from the actual necessities of life. So that's what's going to be coming here, and there's a tough balancing act for the Fed on trying to figure out how to deal with, you know, kind of the 1-2 punch. There's a question on the Fed I thought was good. It was something like, I can't find the question now, I'm on a different page, but it's something like, is the Fed going to do one and done for the Fed? Is this hike that's coming really going to be the last one? Are they going to finally admit they're just stuck with zero interest rate policy forever, just like Japan has been seemingly for most people's entire career, just like the ECB has been? And I understand the sentiment behind that question, and I agree with the thrust of the question, but I don't think it'll be one rate hike. I think it has to be more than that. I just think with the negative Fed funds rate probably going to be more negative, even as they're raising rates, I just don't think it can be one hike. But I do think that the next recession, when the dollar stops dropping, I really do think we're going to once and for all abandon the idea that we can go back to 1995, which I define as when they talk about normal, when we can normalize Federal Reserve policy. I don't think that can happen. I think we're going to need a new basic system. I've talked about this. It's a very high-level thought. Makes people think that it's maybe too high-level. But I talk about the reset that has to come with, I think we need a new economic system. I think we need a new tax system. I think we need new controls on financial institutions. I think we need identity theft protection. I think we need political institutions that people buy into. And I think the next recession is going to lay all of that bare. And so it will be, for a while, we'll go back to the same methods that we used to fight the last few recessions. We're just going to do it with ever greater doses. And it might be that the next dose of heroin to the heroin addict that is the U.S. system may be the fatal dose. So that's how I think about that. And then someone says, what's inflation going to be at year end? I'm going to guess inflation is about where it is today at year end, about 7.5, going higher first. So we may end up with 7.5 for the entire year. Maybe at the very end of the year, it trails off a little bit with lower economic activity. And the final question, which I'm glad somebody asked, am I moving to Florida? Which was reported in some news outlets, and it's completely untrue. I have no plans on moving to Florida. We did move DoubleLine headquarters, which was not in Los Angeles, the city of Los Angeles, to begin with. It was in a different city in Southern California for business planning reasons. That is being moved to Tampa, Florida, to take advantage of the location, the tax structure there, but I'm not becoming do not plan on having any property in Florida, so it's not true that I'm moving to Florida. So that's been reported erroneously. So with that, we're up past an hour and 15 minutes. Thank you for everybody for joining in today. Lots going on. We're one of those periods again where it seems like a decade's worth of change happens in a week. Sometimes there's decades in which no change seems to occur. And then suddenly there's a week in which the whole decade of change is occurring. And we're in one of those things, the old Chinese proverb or warning, I guess, may live in interesting times. Well, we are there. I hope we don't get pulled into this war, but it seems like incrementally we're being dragged in that direction. Stay safe, everybody. I'm glad that we've moved on from all COVID all the time. We're actually relaxing mask mandates, even here in Southern California. So I guess we got bigger problems now with geopolitics and inflation to be worrying about an ineffective cloth mask that people somehow became very fond of. So we're off of that. Next webcast on total return will be in June. I'm sure there'll be quite a bit of change between now and then at a greater arc with greater rapidity. So with that, we'll wrap up the March 2022 total return webcast. Thank you for your support of DoubleLine. So with that, good luck with as we move into the second quarter soon already of 2022. Thanks for your support. Bye for now.